يا علي مدد. الوائز راي ابو علي مشنري وائز نمبر 282.
10th of January 1996. Vice Chancellor Khana Jamaat Khana of Vancouver. On the topic of month of Ramadan and Islam. يا علي مدد، الأميرية as it was announced in Jamaat Khana. I'm going to explain to you the significance of fasting in Islam. There are four ayats in the Holy Quran about fasting. And lengthy, but I will only speak, recite the first ayah, and then I will give you the explanation for them. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Now this is the first ayah. Translation is, O ye. Now this translation I have taken from Iqtal, which has been recommended by Maulana Hazrat Imam. But I'll give you the explanation. Iqtal, he has translated, never commented anything. The translation is, O ye who believe, fasting is prescribed for you. Even as it was prescribed for those before you, that ye may ward off evil. Salat. I want to give you a little background and history. In the 11th year of Hijrah, Nabi Kareem was ascended to Miraj. Now this thing I am quoting you from Mishkatul Masabih, very authentic book of Rasulullah's tradition, hadith. It is prescribed and described like this. When Rasulullah was coming back after the mulaqat of Allah, on the fourth heaven, normally there are seven heavens, Chotu Asman, Hazrat Moses, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, Moses, he greeted him. Nabi Kareem replied. Moses asked, Ya Muhammad, give me some report, some information. Rasulullah gave something that he was talking to God and he had a little dinner with Allah Ta'ala. And then he said, Rasulullah says, Allah has enjoined upon us 50 namaz, 50 salat every day. Hazrat Moses, he got up. Ya Muhammad, 50 salat every day? Nabi said, yes, Allah has enjoined upon my ummah 50 namaz, 50 prayers, 50 times salat every day. Moses said, Ya Muhammad, it's too much. Your ummah may not stand that test. Go back. Beg for some relief. And Rasulullah went back. It's an amusing story, I will tell you. Nabi Karim went back. He just bowed down. Allah says, what is? Ya Muhammad, what's the matter? You have come back. He said, Ya Allah, you have ordained 50 times namaz every day for my ummah. It is too much. People will not be able to afford it. Okay, 25. He was happy, came back. Moses was waiting. What happened, Ya Muhammad? He said, Allah has reduced to 25. Oh, 25, too much. Ya Nabi, your ummah will not stand. Go back. He went back. After all, mind you, Moses was his great grand ancestor, so he respected him. He went back. Allah asked, Ya Muhammad, what's the matter? He said, Ya Allah, my ummah will not stand 25. Oh. Okay, 12. He came back. Very happy. From 50, it came to 1/4. Moses again, he was surprised. From 50 to only 12. Ya Nabi, it's too much. I tell you, time will be very bad and your ummah will not say 12 namaz a day. Still there is time, third time, go back. Allah is very Rahim. Muhammad went back to Allah and Allah said, okay, I reduce it to 5. But in the month of Ramadan, make 30 days fasting. And Moses said, Ya Nabi, again too much. Here, instead of giving relief completely, though he has reduced to 5, but 30 was too much. But Muhammad said, I'm not going back again. So they say, there is a saying in Urdu, Gaite namaze bakshwane, roze gale pade. So that was the story. And that story you can find in Mishkat al-Masabi, you can find in all practical, all Suhasita. There are 6 most authentic collection of ahadith, which is known as Suhasita. Now, I've got an objection. I have talked to Maulvi Mullah. I said, number one, Moses knew more than Allah and Muhammad. Allah didn't know that his ummah, Muhammad's ummah, will not be able to stand 50 namaz every day. And it is on the instruction of Moses and on the request of Moses. Muhammad had to go back 3 times. This hadith was actually coined by a Jew during the time of Muhammad, and it came in the hands of Abu Huraira, and he put in this. This hadith is not authentic, because Muhammad, the seal of all the prophets, Rahmatullil Alameen, the creator of the universe, the creation, he did not know his own ummah, and it was Moses who knew. So therefore, I have given you this thing, because you might come across your friend who maybe, although Muslims are also very ignorant, but some learned people sometime may explain to you, so you can say, it's not authentic. Anyway, Allah says, like the past ummah, the nations in the past, fasting was an act of religious duty. Now before I go again, I have also to explain you one more thing. Normally there are 5 pillars of Iman or 5 articles of faith in Muslims. So one of those five is fasting in the month of Ramadan. One is the declaration of Iman, Shahada. أَشْهَدُ أَنَّ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ بَعْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ بَعْدَهُ وَرَسُولَهُ. This is Shahada. Now, the second and third, the prayer, Namaz, or Salah according to Holy Quran, and Zakah. Now, Zakah, generally, Muslims have taken 2.5% at the end of the year, whatever you have saved. Zakah is not on your income. Zakah is earned, spent, and at the end of the year, whatever you have out of this, give 2.5%. This is Shariati explanation of Zakah, not the Quranic explanation. Quran has never defined Zakah is 2.5%. It is Shariati Zakah, not from the income. Whatever you save at the end of the year, then you pay 2.5%, which is not according to the Quran's order. But I tell you, Namaz is 3 times. In whole Quran, more than 6,000 ayahs. I have read this Quran for the sake of 5 namaz every day, as I have lost a gold coin in the dust. So how to find this gold coin in the dust? Bit by bit I'm clearing the dust to find it. That means I have gone through each and every ayah of the Holy Quran to find where Allah says, you say 5 times namaz, and I have never come across. Now this is not my topic tonight, but because I want to give you the basic principles for the 5 articles that the Ummah stands now. So, Namaz and Zakah, they go together. Whatever God has mentioned about Namaz, Salah, He has mentioned side by side Zakah. وَعَقِمُ السَّلَةِ وَعَقُ Zakah. Establish your prayer. Establish means aqim, means time karo, means be guard to that and never miss a namaz. So therefore, aqim salah wa aqim zakah. Give zakah. The word zakah comes from zakiyah. Zak to purify. Zakah means the amount which purifies your income. The lust, the word tuzkiya from that. So zakah means the amount that you pay which purifies your remaining amount. And it is on your income. Allah also mentions in Quran about khums, 1/5 of your income. Then He again mentions about ushra, ushra Allah. Ushra Allah means the 10% is for the Lord, and 2.5%, although Quran has never mentioned nowhere 2.5%. It was defined by the Holy Prophet. That is for the Rasul. Now this is 12.5%. The remaining 7.5% to make khums. Actually every Muslim must spend 1/5 of his income, 10% for Allah, 2.5% for Rasul, and 7.5% which is according to your own liking amongst your nearest kith and kin or friends or your neighbors or anywhere. So 7.5% remains to be spent on our relatives, poor relatives, or those people who are in need, who are in trouble. So out of your income you must also spend something. This also comes in the category of khairat. Khairat means charity. And every Muslim is particularly pressed for doing some kind of charity. Nabi says, if you have nothing, even a smile is a charity. When you see someone, smile. It is your good thought. Nabi says, even a smile is a charity. So I'm coming back here. Shahada is compulsory. The declaration of Imam. Then comes prayer. Then comes zakat. These two have no option. You must say prayer. Whenever you are, you must say prayer. Mind you, sometimes our brother Muslims, they, because of their ignorance, amongst the youngsters, they say, hey, Ismailis, you are not Muslims because you don't say Salat, don't say Namaz. Tell him, it means that you don't know Islam. There are many reports in the history and in tradition of Prophet Muhammad, many, many things that people have recited prayer while they are sitting, they are lying in bed, even by walking. Rasulullah himself has said namaz while he was riding the back of a camel. He was also, when he was sick, he was absolutely at the last moment, he couldn't come out. So namaz, the prayer or dua, actually, here again, I tell you one more thing for your information. Before Islam, there was a religious community known as Sa'ibin. Suad Alif Aimbay Yenun. Sa'ibin. They are very close to those people who are known now as Parsis. They worship either the sun or the fire. Their people had the same typical system of prayer. They would stand, say some prayer, go down to their touching the knees, that means bend, then stand again and go back in sajda. The same pattern has been adopted, had been adopted and has been adopted up to now by the Holy Prophet. That was the method of prayer. It's not necessary that you just adopt the same system, although in common we follow. We also follow when we say Eid Namaz. A very great man, many of you may be knowing, Professor A.A. Faizi. Imam Sultan Ahmad Shah liked him very much. And he was a collaborator and co-worker in Ismaili Society with Vladimir Ivanov. Professor Faizi was a Bukhara man and he knew Ismailism very much. I do not know why he asked me, though he might be new. He asked him, he said, why you people say your namaz in Jamaat Khana while sitting? Why don't you adopt this Sharia system? I said, Professor, you are far beyond than me in knowledge and this thing, information. He said, I may be knowing, but I want to listen from an Ismaili missionary. He said, listen. Generally Muslims, they do not attend mosque regularly every time in the morning, evening, like Ismaili. He nodded, he said, yes. I think Muslims living in a vicinity, and if there is a mosque, hardly 20% will attend mosque daily. He said, maybe. I said, we Ismailis, we go to Jamaat. Old people, young people, children, women, suckling babies, sleeping babies in the lap of mother, and they are sitting in Jamaat. If we have to adopt that system, as we are doing the namaz, facing Qibla, أقامت ركوع السجود. I said that system will make disturbance in the Jamaat. How can those women who are having their sleepy babies in the mat, many old people, they cannot stand suffering with gulps or rheumatism, many pregnant women. So there will be some are standing, some are sitting. So there is no system and organization. She laughed. He said, very well done. I said, we go to Jamaat Khana. It is our mosque. We go for prayer morning, evening. Practically 50% Ismailis go to Jamaat Khana every day. On Friday, there may be more than 60%, rather 70%. On Chand Raat or big days, there may be 90 to 95%. He says, you are right. Muslims don't go to mosque. Majority of Muslims do not know namaz, but they will attack to us. So I'm giving you a clue from Hadith. You can say your namaz by sitting. You can say your namaz by standing. You can say your namaz even while you are walking or even cycling. So our system is absolutely right. What I wanted to tell you, that according to Quran, namaz you must perform and there is no option for it. Similarly, zakat, you must pay the soul. There is no option to that. Now, two more things, fasting and Hajj. These two things are not as necessary as namaz and zakat, because in these two things there is an option. Here it is. Allah says, this is ayat number 2 from Surah Al-Baqarah 184. Fast. A certain number of days. And for him who is sick among you or on a journey, the same number of other days. That is, suppose a man is on traveling, he cannot just keep all these numbers. So when he returns during the day or during that month or other month, but in 1 year, he has to perform 30 fasting days. So therefore Allah says, the same number of other days, and for those, now see, the option is here, and for those who can afford it, there is a ransom. Afford means monetary. There is a ransom. The feeding of a man in need. Allah says, if you cannot keep fast, then you give some ransom, badlodiya, there is option. Feed a miskeen, feed a beggar. And for those who can afford it, there is a ransom, the feeding of a man in need. But whoso doeth good of his own accord, it is better for him, and that he fast is better for you if ye did but know. If you keep fast, Allah says it is better to you. There is something profit for you. There are benefits in that. But if you cannot, and you have that much money to feed someone, because in those days people were very poor, then you can give a ransom. A token for that. This is option in fasting. But he says, if you keep fasting, it is good for you. The third ayat says, the month of Ramadan, why fasting has been enjoined upon Ummah? The month of Ramadan, in which was revealed the Quran, a guidance for mankind. This is the reason. In many of my lives, in the past, I have been telling the Jamaat that even our big Shukrawari and these 30 fasting days in the month of Ramadan are an expression of our gratitude to God that He has given us Islam as His deen. So he says, Quran was revealed as guidance for mankind and clear proofs of the guidance and the creation. The criterion of right and wrong, and whoso ever of you is present, let him fast the month, and whosoever of you is sick or on a journey, let him fast the same number of other days. Allah desireth for you ease. He desireth not hardship for you. And He desireth that you should complete the period, complete the month of 30 fastings, and that He should magnify Allah for having guided you, that means Islam. And that pre-adventure, He may be thankful. Because Allah has guided you through Muhammad, so this is our gratitude to keep fast. Fasting is necessary. But those people who cannot because of health reason, then they must pay some ransom. And that ransom has not been decided. Here Allah has decided that you feed a miskin, a needy person. Help him. Now here, the word feed is to give him some food, not money. Now how to put in practice amongst us, I'll tell you later on. Now there is a very important thing. Hazrat Mawlana, Imam Sultan Muhammad Shah Nakar, he made a farman. Show of religious practice. This is the farman of Imam Sultan Muhammad Shah. Mawla said, show of religious practice without being conscious about it. Very deep meaning. Show of religious practice without being conscious about it is an animal's action. We are sitting in Janathana thinking about our business or other things. Body is here, mind is outside. This is not a prayer. Mawla said, this is an animal action. If we keep an animal away from food and water, it may be said that the animal is keeping a fast, isn't it? That's what we are doing. Likewise, what benefit can a man derive if he acts in the same way? This is from Kalam-e-Imam-e-Mubeen. Lord Mawla wanted to say that those people who only shut their mouth to put something in it, that means fasting, Mawla said, likewise, animal does. But if you are fasting and also you are having the fear of God that you may not do and commit any sin or bad things or evil things, then fasting has some meaning. Imam Zainul Abidin also said in the same manner. Imam Zainul Abidin said, fasting is not only to close your mouth so that no mortal goes inside, but fasting is to keep yourself away mentally and physically from evil doing. That is fasting. Mawlana Imam Sultan Mahmudshi again said, a true mu'min does not abstain only from food. Now this is the farman usually Ismailis, they speak and they refer to each other, but they have not gone into the study of it. A true mu'min does not abstain only from food in this month of Ramadan, but he observes abstinence from evils throughout the year, all the 360 days, and keeps himself clean of sins through abstinence and prayer. Imam Sultan Mahmud Shah or ever any Imam has never said, don't keep month of Ramadan Roza. Never. Here also again, Imam says, only to keep yourself away from food, that's not the significance. The significance is abstinence from evil doing and evil thinking. And this is only not only for 30 days of Ramadan, but whole years. It doesn't say that you don't keep the month fasting. According to this holy Quran, as I have explained to you, fasting, Allah says, is beneficial. Its benefiting sites are very numerous. Most of you know me, that I'm very much interested in naturopathy, natural ways of curing and healing. It is my pet subject right from my childhood. I have studied medicine in many ways. Actually, I wanted to become a doctor, but Mawla wished me to become a missionary. But my thirst for the medical reading has never been quenched. And I have read in many vast ways, even this fasting as a cure. Fasting as a cure. Allah's word that there are benefits for you, absolutely true. First 3 days may be a little bit heavier, but for fifth, then you become as a routine keeping fast. Fasting has been enjoined upon God. But as I said, Allah has given option. If you cannot fast by certain reason, then you must pay some ransom. Now what you want to pay, it is up to you. Because he has not done anything. But according to the situation during the time of Rasulullah, there were too many beggars and poor people, so Allah feel for them. You can pick up anything you like according to your own affording condition. But those people who cannot fast, they can on other day when they are fit, fast. If not in the month of Ramadan because of either heat or because of cold, then Allah has given throughout the year, you should make 35 days of fasting. There was my colleague, poor fellow died, Allah may keep him in his nur. He used to keep fast every Friday. Sometimes he may miss, but he was completing 35, 36, sometimes even 40. With this intention and niya, if you keep fast on every week one day suitable to you, that covers this command. Because Allah has given this option that those people who are sick, they cannot fast during the month of Ramadan, or those people who are traveling during the month of Ramadan, they cannot keep fasting. Okay, Allah says, on other days. He has given a kind of truth. There is a freedom of that, freedom of option. But I tell you one thing must be cleared from your mind, please. I beg you, never tell any person that we Ismailis are not fasting. Amara roja apna mate nahi. It is the wrong attitude. Imam has never told us not to keep fast. If Muslims are asking you, you can tell them many Muslims also don't keep fast. Many Ismailis keep fast. It is not a principle of Ismaili faith that we say we don't keep fast. Fasting is very good. Practically, as far as I have gone in history and study, because it's only 29 prophets from 124,000, 29 prophets who are very high quality prophets like a Rasul, their history tells me every prophet, and that may be true for all 124,000 Nabis, every prophet, before declaring his prophethood, his Nabuwa, they were fasting. He was fasting. Moses fasted for 40 days before going to Mount Sinai. When he came back, so he said that I'm prophet of God. Jesus also, he was fasting for 40 days before he was caught. Rasulullah, he was in the cave of Hira, and it was again the 40th night. That was 23rd night of Ramadan. He received the revelation. That was the 23rd night of month of Ramadan, which is known as Laylatul Qadr. If you read history, Rasulullah, he was doing some commission basis business, taking some goods from Makkah to other places like Iraq and Sham, Syria, with his uncle Abu Talib. A wealthy woman, Khadija, he heard good name of Muhammad. Being most honest, he called him and said that I request you also just to take my goods for selling and whatever commission you charge. Rasulullah was doing commission business. And Bibi Khadija became so much attracted to him. One day she proposed to get married and he accepted. And he married Bibi Khadija when she was 40 years old widow and Muhammad was 25 years bachelor. They married. Bibi Khadija was very nice. This was her third marriage. Twice she became widow. And she watched him very much, very closely. And then she one day said, I have a lot of money. My Lord, don't work. He said, Khadija, I was actually waiting for that opportunity. Thank you that you have relieved me from earning. She had a lot of money. So every day, this great Prophet Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would go about 3 miles out of Makkah, and there in the mountain there was a cave. He used to go there, sit there alone in seclusion, and think about God. Every day he would go there and come back little afternoon. Slowly, 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 his interest became deeper and deeper. So he would go in the morning, come back in the night. So Bibi Khadija used to send some food with her slave, and he would go there, sit there, wait, until Muhammad ate and came back. Now this increased in that way that Rasulullah wouldn't come back during the night time and he may stay there one or two days. The food was sent there. Slowly, this went to so much, sometimes he would sit for 7 days, without food, without sleep. It was his 40th year of his life. When he developed this kind of habit to such an extent that one day he sat for 40 days, as one report said, 30 days. Anyway, it was definitely more than a month. He sat and sat and sat and sat without water, without food, without sleep. And it was either the 30th night from one report or 40th night from other report that he got revelation. What I wanted to tell you, even the prophets, they were keeping fasting for the sake of one thing. May I tell you? Fasting has direct connection with our spiritual advancement. Those people who go deep into spirituality, particularly in meditation, and they crave for some light or some happiness, some favor from the Lord, they abstinate food, sleep, water. It is also in our Gidan. Jena ridae satcho shahava se Eta koyam na bhave jena ridae apno gurva se Tako nindra na ave nindra ta jo vira bhai ginan vicharo mora bhai. Ginan have everything. Allah telling us to keep fast has some significance. He tells us he is the creator, he knows our in and out, good and bad, and he says by keeping fast it is good for you. It's a beneficial, and the benefit is mental, spiritual, physical. If really a man or a woman keeps fasting as a medicine even, the health will increase. Health will develop in the good side, positive way. First of all, it attacks the intestine and the stomach. Fasting attacks the stomach and the intestine. Now what is the attack? No food. When they are deprived of food, the stomach shrinks. Normally, because we are eating every day, 3, 4, 5, 6 times, we never give any time and moment to stomach to take rest. Even while we are sleeping, in many stomachs, the food is there. That poor fellow is working day and night like the heart, which never sleeps. And when stomach is empty, the intestines have no work. Because intestine gets anything from the stomach. So stomach is clear, it shrinks, becomes stronger. But because the stomach is not working, the liver doesn't supply bile to the stomach for digestion of the food. So liver also gets rest. Now, when the liver is not working for 12 hours, so the supply of blood is not necessary to liver for making and creating bile. So the heart also is taking some rest. Now, because there is no food in stomach and intestine, So no need of brain to direct them, make this acid or make that acid. So that lobby in our brain, which is controlling our digestion system, it is at rest. Now see, how many things are at rest? Another thing. Because there is no food supply during the 12 hours period of the day, so many poisonous and toxic. So our urine also clears, and then the intestine gets clarity. This again comes to our eyesight. Those people who are suffering indigestion, I tell you, 99% they will have trouble with their eyesight. Similarly, those people who are suffering with constipation and constipation because of our bad food habits, they are also suffering many, many ailments like gout, lumbago, arthritis, rheumatism, and so many other ailments because of constipation. Rasulullah Pak sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam has said in hadith, Al-qabzun umul amara'at. Constipation is the mother of all sickness and disease. And that's absolutely right. I know it. So, during the month of Ramadan, when we keep fast, our intestine clears all the bad things. The whole system is cleared and rejuvenated. And thinking becomes clearer. Why these spiritual people like Prophet Muhammad and other great prophets, they were keeping fasting because of spiritual side. Those people who cannot just concentrate in ibadat, when they come to me and we discuss, I tell them, if it is possible, keep one day rojo every week. Fast at least once a week. Okay, if you cannot right away do that, do this thing. Do not eat anything. Only drink water in the morning until when you break your fast. Only water. Nothing else. No tea, no juice, nothing. Only water. It will cleansing effect in your whole body system. So fasting spiritually is also very nice because when the system is clear, blood is nice, brain is at rest, you can concentrate nicely. And spirituality has a direct connection with fasting. So Allah says that this system of fasting is beneficial to you. Alhamdulillah, we are having the month of Ramadan within next 10 or 12 days. If we can fast, it is better. It's a religious duty. Those people who cannot, they should make some kind of ransom. And we can also, as I said, according to the farman of Allah, you can make this fasting spread out in a whole year, once every week. But those people who do in the month of Ramadan, why in the month of Ramadan? Allah says, because Quran was revealed in this month, so this month is Mubarak month. And Allah has given you His guidance to Muhammad and Quran. So it is an expression of gratitude to keep fasting during the month of Ramadan. And here I have given you the translation of these four ayat. I have given you the farman of Imam Sultan Muhammad Shah. And other Imam is also slowly drifting us towards Islam. We are Muslim, of course, but I mean Islam is there, but towards the general Ummah of Islam, so that he may one day have to perform certain important duties in the future, but never say that we Ismailis don't fast. It's wrong. Mawla bless you always. Mawla may fulfill all your good wishes. Mawla may enhance your iman and give love. Mawla may give you power to make ibadah, to be good, to be diligent in our righteous duty. We may be obedient to Mawla Baba. We may be absolutely loyal to Mawla Baba. And all the things that in this world and the next which are beneficial to us, Mawla may grant you and your progeny all the time. Mawla bless you. Nekum Bajapuri Kare, Sukhya Bhakti.